যে অ্যাক্টিভেট করে রেখেছিলাম না, তো ওটাকে তো চেঞ্জ করতে হবে আবার। এটা আমার তো এটা অন্য ইয়েতে সে মানে করা আছে, আমার এন্ট্রিটা মানে রেজিস্টার করানো আছে। দ্যাট ইজ ওকে, হি ইজ অনেবল দেয়ার।
হ্যাঁ স্যার ইজ হিয়ার, স্যার ইজ হিয়ার।
ওকে ওকে ওকে। আচ্ছা এখানে 29 জন দেখছি। আই ক্যান্ট সি ইউ, ওয়্যার আর ইউ? ও ভিডিওটা অফ আছে না তোমার? ওকে হ্যাঁ, এখন তো আমার ইন্টারনেটটা উইদাউট হটস্পটই আসছে, আমি হটস্পট চালাইনি এখনো। এবার অসুবিধা হলে তখন চালাতে হবে। আচ্ছা থার্ড সেম, তোমরা কজন কিরকম এসেছো দেখো তো। আর ইয়ে অনির্বাণ আছে ওখানে, মানে ইউটিউবে কি কেউ জয়েন করেছে? না এমনি জাস্ট জিজ্ঞেস করছি। হ্যাঁ 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 ঠিক আছে, দেরি আছে তো এখনো। ও দেরি কি না, অলরেডি 5:28, আমি খেয়াল করিনি, আই ওয়াজ টু লেট। আচ্ছা আরেকটা কথা, না না এখন রেকর্ড করার দরকার নেই, এখন রেকর্ডটা পরে। ও তো স্যারও এসে গেছেন। হ্যালো স্যার, গুড আফটারনুন, গুড ইভিনিং, মধুমিতা দি হিয়ার। হ্যালো স্যার, ও হি ইজ হিজ অডিও ইজ মিউট। ওকে হ্যালো স্যার,
এবার শুনতে পাচ্ছেন? হ্যাঁ হ্যাঁ শুনতে পাচ্ছেন।
হ্যাঁ গুড ইভিনিং,
গুড ইভিনিং, গুড ইভিনিং, গুড ইভিনিং। দুটো জিনিস, একটা জিনিস আমি একটু দেখে নেব।
হ্যাঁ নিশ্চয়ই।
দেয়ার আর টু থিংস আই ওয়ান্ট টু সি, এইটা একটু দেখে নেব, তারপরে আই উইল।
না না দেরি আছে, ইউ টেক ইওর টাইম।
হ্যাঁ না একটা জিনিস আমি দেখাবো। সো আচ্ছা, ক্যান ইউ সি হোয়াট এভার আই এম শোয়িং? ক্যান ইউ সি? Can you see what I am showing?
Yes sir, this is visible.
I mean just, it actually, because you know, I am painting it with you, so you know, these are very difficult to scan, right? So that is one thing I want to show. I want to show Changa, which I will do, don't worry. Just a minute. Dharti Ma, আর একটা জিনিস আই ওয়ান্ট টু শো অ্যান্ড সি ইফ আই ক্যান শো ইউ দিস। আই এম ট্রাইং টু প্রেজেন্ট সামথিং। সো ক্যান ইউ সি দিস?
ইয়েস স্যার, ইয়েস স্যার।
ক্যান ইউ সি দিস? ওকে, দ্যাট উইল বি মোর নিডেড। Okay, so let me stop sharing. Yes, that is it. Do that for me. Let me think, because there are so many stuff. Okay, so when it is supposed to take place?
So just after your formal introduction. So shall we start?
No, I like to 5 minutes, 2 minutes. Let people, there may be some more people coming. Right? So like,
yes.
Maybe wait for, maybe start at 35. Will that be okay?
Yes, sir. Absolutely. Absolutely.
Thank you, Madhubita Di. Thank you. Thank you for the invitation. Is this mostly for the students?
Yes.
Wonderful. I hope I make sense. I think one thing that I have to do is probably pin myself, right? Otherwise, others may lose me, right?
Anyway, many more are expected to join, but অহনা বাকিরা কি ঢুকেছে ওই মানে জাকিয়াকে দেখলাম বাকিরা অভিষেক আর
ওরা কি নবনীতা ইজ হিয়ার অলরেডি অ্যাডমিটিং পিপল
ওকে না স্যারকে দেখো লেট করিয়েও লাভ নেই কটা বাজে 5টা
না না দ্যাটস ফাইন আমার আমার কোনো অসুবিধা নেই দ্য অনলি থিং ইজ সবাই স্টুডেন্ট তো দিদি
হ্যাঁ না হয়তো কোনো আমাদের যারা নেইবারিং কলেজ আছে সেখানকার ফ্যাকাল্টিরাও আসতে পারেন জয়েন করতে পারেন এই মুহূর্তে তুমি কি অহনা ক্যান ইউ সি এনিওয়ান নো পারহ্যাপস
নট ইয়েট
আচ্ছা নট ইয়েট তাহলে তুমি কি স্যার যদি ইয়ে করেন তাহলে তুমি শুরু করে দাও বিকজ হি উইল বি লেট না
লেটস ওয়েট ফর টু মোর ইয়া লেটস ওয়েট ফর টু মোর মিনিটস
ওকে ওকে ওকে
তুমি তো আমি আছি আজকে
কে ওই ইন্দ্রানিধি ও ওয়েলকাম ওয়েলকাম ইন্দ্রানিধি আই ক্যান সি ইউ ওয়েলকাম ইন্দ্রানিধি
ওকে
ক্যান ইউ হিয়ার মি লেট মি ইন্ট্রোডিউস ডক্টর ইন্দ্রানিধি স্যার আই এম টকিং টু ডক্টর পিনাকি দে সো শি ইজ ওয়ান্স অ্যাপন এ টাইম শি ওয়াজ মাই কলিগ
ওকে
আই দ্য ডিপার্টমেন্ট অফ ইংলিশ নিস্তারিণী কলেজ পুরুলিয়া নাও শি টার্নস আউট টু বি দ্য প্রিন্সিপাল অফ দ্য কলেজ
Afternoon,
so, okay, he is Dr. Pinaki De.
No, just call me Pinaki. I mean, just prefixing doctor sounds so odd.
Enjoyable session. Is Chandana there? Indranidhi?
Chandana?
Okay, we'll come later. Tomar student ra ashbe?
Ami bolechi koyekjonke. Jani na dhukeche kina.
Acha. Very nice of you. Glad to see you. Ahona, I'm switching off my video. Sir, I'm switching off my video.
Oh, that's fine. I cannot switch it off, unfortunately.
I don't know, obviously. Yo.
I have to pin myself, I think. And Madhubita Di, don't call me sir. I am much, much junior. So
okay. Pinaki
would be fine. And I really don't like prefixing doctor before. We are not doctors as such. We have just got a degree. So just Pinaki would be fine.
Okay, nah, something wrong.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Can everybody hear me? Students, can you all hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir, loud and clear.
Wonderful. I mean, So let thank you. I mean, I've seen yes, and don't mention sir at the every step. I mean, I feel a bit odd. Let it be a bit of a conversation rather than a very scholarly session, and I'll talk about certain things about the art, which will probably interest you. One of the reasons I can talk more authentically about Gondart is because I was there in Patangar. So Patangar is the village in Madhya Pradesh where this art is practiced. And I will try to talk through the intricacies of the art as well as Vimayat. So I will talk about the art first and then go to the
So, sir, should we start now?
I have no problems. It's completely up to you. It depends. If you begin, I am okay.
Ma'am? MD ma'am?
Madhumita di's video has frozen. So somehow, is she connected?
I guess so.
No, Madhumita di has left the meeting.
So I suppose think... she's facing, yes, connectivity problem.
Yeah, so let Madhumita di come back.
Yes, then you
So Ahona, what do you do?
Sorry, sir, I didn't get the question.
What do you do, Ahona? I mean, do we start or?
I just called up MD ma'am. She is rejoining. Perhaps one more minute, though she was though she did tell us to start.
So you what can, you I think you can and she can join in, right? I think that right. would be nice.
All right, absolutely.
I mean, if she doesn't mind, I mean, yeah.
No, in fact, ma'am was telling me to start in that.
Okay, fine. Okay.
So, very good. Welcome to Chagatai College English Department. And even... this formal introduction is quite
it's cutting off.
So am I audible?
It is now better.
Okay. I suppose I need to keep the mouthpiece closer.
Yeah.
So a very good evening, sir. Welcome to Chagatai College English Department. And of course, as always, it is a sheer pleasure to know your views, to listen to your lecture. And before I formally introduce sir to everyone else present here, all the participants here, Dr. Pinaki Dey is someone who breeds comics, someone who all his students look up to. And this is not an overstatement. This is reality. This is even I must say, sir, that I tried to copy you so and at so many junctures. I seriously tried to copy you, though I can never be a half or one tenth. That I can't be one tenth as good as you, or maybe 100.
Please, but still, don't embarrass me with all these accolades. You just go on with the introduction.
Okay, coming to the formal introduction of Dr. Pinaki Dey. So Dr. Pinakide is a multiple award-winning graphic illustrator designer who regularly works for renowned publishers like Penguin Random House, HarperCollins, Hachette, Routledge, Primus, Oxford University Press, Singapore University Press, Bloomsbury, Orient Black Swan, Worldview, Pan Picador, Simon & Schuster, Permanent Black, Alchemy, Sage, Roli, Chait Academy, Rupa, and many others. He has designed almost 500 book covers to date. He is the winner of Publishing Next Prize for the best book cover design in India twice in 2017 and 2019. His book cover for Kalkata, Saikunal Basu, won the prestigious Oxford Bookstore Prize for the best cover design in India at Jaipur Literary Fest 2017. His layout design and footage archival manuscript.
Sorry, I was out for some technical reason or anything. Okay, you start.
Thank you, Madhumati.
I did actually start, ma'am. And just one thing for the participants, please keep your microphones off, please. Mics and camera off. So his book cover for Kalkata by Kunal Basu won the prestigious Oxford Bookstore Prize for the best cover design in India at Jaipur Literary Fest 2017. His layout design on Chhatrapati Prize archival manuscript has drawn accolades from all across the globe. A Charles Wallace Trust Fellow, his PhD is on comics theory. Dr. Day is one of the editors of the prestigious Animal Magazine Long Form, published from HarperCollins 2018. Which is generally regarded as the first global comics magazine from India. He's the Indian comic advisor of Mangasia, the biggest ever exhibition of Asian comics curated by Paul Gravett for the Barbican London, sorry. His book-length comics on Partition is due next year. Dr. Day juggles his creative work with academics as he has a day job as an associate professor of Raja Piyari Mohan College, Uttarpara. So that's it, sir.
Thank you, Ahona. Thank you, Madhumita Di. Thank you, all the students who have actually taken a bit of your time to listen to me. I don't know whether I'll make sense. First of all, can you all hear me clearly? Am I clear, crystal clear to all of you? Am I?
Yes, sir.
Wonderful.
Yes.
So,
yes, sir.
Yeah. Okay, wonderful. So if you are all crystal clear, let me first of all approach this text in a wonderful, I've got the message. Thank you so much. So one good thing that I want to talk about is, of course, Bhimayana. I'll talk about the text. I will try to talk about the intricacies of the text. It's very, very difficult to talk about the text in such a short time. I will try to do at least some sections of the text and try to give you an idea of how you navigate this kind of text. Art intensive text. But before that, let me talk a bit about the Gond art. So I will begin my lecture. I'll almost spend 15 to 20 minutes of my lecture to actually talk about Gond art, because at the heart of Bhimayana is this art, Gond art. So what is it? Who actually are the Gonds? Who are the Pardhan Gonds? Basically the people who actually draw these kind of pictures. What is their style? Where do you find them? And what is the politics behind the adaptation of an art form which was normally done on walls of their hutments and transfer them into pen and paper? There must be an ideological shift for them. So that's a very, very important question I will talk about. After that, I will talk about Bhimayana's content. I will not talk too much about it, but I will give you an introduction of the structure of the book. And the last part, I will try to analyze the application of the Gond art and the way it influences the reading of Bhimayana. You know, the ideological reading of the text itself. First of all, let me tell you, this is very, very important, is that the word Gond, you know, it has a kind of a old, you know, Dravidian expression. It comes from an old Dravidian expression called Kond, K-O-N-D. Now, if you want to know what is Kond, Kond is basically green mountains. Now, since they live in the middle part of India, mostly in Madhya Pradesh, and of course now also parts of Chhattisgarh, you can understand why the name Kond is actually there. It became Gond. So Gond comes from Kond, which basically means green mountains. Okay, now you have to understand that we normally look at Gond tribes as a monolithic entity. It is not. In fact, the kind of drawing that you are seeing is actually done by what I call a group of within the Gonds. It's called the Pardhan Gonds. Note the spelling, it's not Pradhan, it's Pardhan, P-A-R-D-H-A-N. So it is basically the Pardhan Gonds who do this kind of paintings. Now, who are Pardhan Gonds? So Pardhan Gonds, you can call them the sect, but I think I will avoid the word sect because it's a loaded word. I will actually use a group within the Gond tribe who are basically storytellers. Okay, for example, you know, if you divide, you know, tribal societies are sometimes divided according to the work they do. So the Pardhan Gonds, P-A-R-D-H-A-N, Pardhan Gonds, are basically storytelling gods. And they used to tell story in accompaniment with a musical instrument. And that musical instrument, it's a string instrument called Bana, B-A-N-A. So basically, if you look at the early depiction of the Gonds or the Pardhan Gonds in particular, you can see that they are basically storytellers within the Gonds community, and they used to tell stories in a song, in a sing-song manner, of course, with the accompaniment of Bana, a kind of stringed kind of instrument. If you look at the old Indian anthropologist, of course, a very important one, Verrier Elwin, he actually lived among the Gonds. So the earliest, what I call study, in a way, anthropological study about the Gonds can be found in the accounts made by Verrier Elwin. Now you have to understand the Pardhan Gonds, you know, they are also somebody who not only tell stories, but they also illustrate, they also paint. Now, it is very important to note that the Gonds never painted on pen and paper earlier. This very idea of painting on canvas or paper is a very new kind of a thing, accruement. You have to understand that earlier they used to paint on the walls. Imagine the Santals, for example, the Santals here in Bengal. All of their art was on the walls of their houses, right, of their hutments. So similarly with the Gonds. So when you look at the old Gond art, they used to paint on the walls of their hutments. Now you have to understand that if you look at the Gond community, particularly the Pardhan Gond, if you look at them specifically, you will see that there are many festivals. Yeah, somebody mentioned Pottochitra. You are right. Pottochitra, of course, was drawn on a piece of cloth. So Pottochitra, of course, was not drawn on hutments. It is drawn on a pot of cloth. So that is why it is called Pottochitra. Okay. So it is not like that. It was done only on the walls, like a fresco. You can understand. So they were done on the walls of the huts, and that is why they were not done on, of course, paper, canvas, cloth, nothing. Okay, so art was the matrix on which they used to etch their work or their what their creativity. Now you have to understand that there are many what I called natural storytelling myths within the Gonds. So it's a mix of their own rooted myths and, you know, some stuff from mainstream, what I call Northern India and Southern India also got mixed. So for example, Gondwani, when they tell a story about the king of the Gonds, when they tell a story about the about their own tribes, it's called Gondwani. If they talk about Ram, of course, Ram is never a Gond pantheon, but you can understand it came from North India, then it will be called Ramayani. Or if they talk about the Pandavas, which is again part of the Mahabharata myth, which again filtered down to them in a very complicated way. I cannot talk about it here. It will completely distract me from the lecture. Then it will be called Pandavani. So let us look at Gondwani, which is their old storytelling thing. And if you look their worldview, it is not the worldview that we have. They have a completely different way of looking at the world. And that's very, very important to understand. So for example, some of the dances, for example, you know, for, you know, they have festivals. And when the Gond tribes dance, their dances are, sometimes I can call you Birha, for example, Karma. I can remember one or two, so not even Dadariya, I remember. Okay, Shaila, Dadra. These are the kind of dance forms, and they celebrate certain aspects of their life. So, you know, it's all very different from the kind of life we are acquainted with. You know, we look at the tribes in a very exotic manner. For us, you know, their world is the perpetual other. And it will, of course, remain other, but at least we should make a kind of an effort to enter into the world. And if you cannot enter into their world, I think it's very difficult to enter into the world of Bhimayana. Because at the heart of Bhimayana is the philosophy behind the, you know, making of Gond art. So let me go a bit further. So what happened is they have also their own pantheons, you know, what I call pantheons, their own gods. Of course, they are pagans in that sense, but they have their own pantheons and they are all nature gods, as you can easily understand. Of course, their greatest god is Baradev, Badadev, B-A-D-A-D-E-V, Badadev or Baradev. And he is basically represented by a tree, which is very prevalent there, Saja tree, Saja. So Saja, Saja Gach. So basically Saja tree is, you know, so Baradev lives under the Saja tree. So whenever they see the Saja tree, for them, it's a holy place. It's a place of contact with Badadev. So even their very idea of religion is extremely difficult, different. Of course, they worship nature as religious entities, various aspects of nature as religious entities. So Thakur Dev, again, another god, is basically represented by another tree, the Pakri tree, okay? Or the Karma Dev is actually represented by the Karma tree. So these are the trees that you see in their land. And all these trees are extremely important. So one of the most important iconography of Gond art, and let me show you, because I have a lot of Gond arts with me. Now, of course, it is extremely costly to get, you know, Gond art, to buy Gond art. But, you know, I have some books as well. I will show you some so that you understand what I mean. The tree of life is a very, very important, what I call iconography in Gond art. You know, the tree of life. And so any kind of depiction of a tree is associated with the very idea of life. So can I show you? So can you see this? Can you all see this?
Yes, sir.
Can you see this? So this is a depiction of a tree. And if you can look at the tree is not just a tree for them. So, you know, there is a beautiful word in Gond art. It's called Gond art doesn't represent, it signifies. And that's so true. So when you look at a tree, it's not just a tree. It's also what I call the sum total of life force. And you will see in Bhimayana, this kind of iconography will be used frequently. Now let us go a bit further, okay? And let me see how, you know, they actually walk. And this is very, very important. So if you look at their old style of paintings, you will understand that they don't work on pen and paper and canvas. And they make their own colors. It's very, very interesting to know how they make their colors. And nobody, no academic will tell you this, because until you go to Patangar, the village, for example, in Pottachitra, you go to a village in Midnapur called Pingla, right? So Naya Gram bole ekta gram ache Pingla er kache. That is where you go. So you go to Naya. So similarly, in Madhya Pradesh, close to Bhopal, you go to a place called Patangar. And how do they make their colors? And it's fascinating to see them make their colors. So they don't use artificial pigments. Now they use, of course, in Bhimayana they used, but originally they never used artificial pigments. They make their own colors. In this respect, you can find a similarity with Ramkinkor Bage, who used to make his own colors when he was in Shantiniketan. So what are the sources of their color? Again, very, very important. Look at the way the natural elements play a role. I've already told you the importance that trees have in their life. Look at the importance that earth has in making their lives colorful. You know, the earth, and you know, mati, the earth. So for example, how do you get black? Very simple, wood coal. You use wood coal for black, okay? For white, you use chui mati, chui soil, C-H-U-I. C-H-U-I, chui soil. Now you have to understand that chui soil is actually available in a hills near their place called the Barindh Hills. Okay, it's a kind of a lime matrix that you get, the chui soil. Then how do you get the red color? There is another soil called Geru soil, which is available in another hill called the Dhuti Hill. All these are nearby. You can just make a go. You can go there. So Dhuti Hill, from there they get the red soil. Then the dark red, they don't get from a soil. They get the extract from a plant which they call Tinsak plant. So Tinsak gach, Tinsak mura. So Tinsak gach, they get their dark red from Tinsak, T-I-N-S-A-K. Okay. The yellow color is from a specific soil called the Ramraj soil. Locally, it is called Ramraj. And the Ramraj is actually available in the Amarkantak Hills. The same leaves, there is a plant called Sem, S-E-M. Same leaves forms the basis of dark green color. And if you mix same leaves with cow dung, you get a light green color. Mix it with water. And the entire thing will be painted on a white background. Imagine you do putti, right, on the wall. Similarly, there is a white matrix which will be given on the wall. And that matrix is composed of the Pidor soil, P-I-D-O-R. So the Pidor soil is the matrix on which they will draw. It's fascinating. So all the colors are basically natural. Now, this was the way, you know, Gond art was done. Two more important things are necessary, and these are necessary to understand Bhimayana as well. So whenever the Gond art, they used to paint on the walls, for example, like frescoes, there would be
frames or demarcations, in a way you can call separators. So for example, you want to paint one kind of painting and then you want to separate and paint another kind of painting. How do you separate them? They used a very interesting feature called Digna, D-I-G-N-A, and remember this. Because in Bhimayana, Durga and of course Subhash, Durga Vyam and Durga Bai and Subhash Vyam, the husband-wife duo of Gond artists, they will use this Digna as frames. So they will not use the normative comics panel, which are mostly rectangular or circular, mostly rectangular in nature, but they will use Digna as the frames. So instead of hard lines, they will actually use Digna, separators. And the entire painting, the composition, the layout on the wall will be called Bhitti Chitra. Bhitti Chitra, B-H-I-T-T-I-C-H-I-T-R-A. So in a way, what you see inside the Digna is the Bhitti Chitra. So in Bhimayana, if you look at the text, you will see that instead of a normal comics panel, you have the separator, which is Digna, and the content within the panel is like the matrix of the wall, which contains the separator, the layout of the wall that contains the separator, Bhitti Chitra. So the combination of the Bhitti Chitra and Digna done on the walls of their own hutments was transferred in a very innovative manner. They were almost adapted in order to create a comics-like sequentiality in Bhimayana. Now let us go a bit further. So when did the change take place? Now that's also very, very important. So there are three things. First is Digna. Secondly is Bhitti Chitra. So I've given you a term called Digna. Digna is a separator, the frame. And I will show you what is a Digna when I show you Bhimayana. And use these terms. It will give you marks. And not only that, it will actually be proper. Don't just use anything that is actually written in a book. Digna. In fact, the word Digna is referred there in the book itself. In the last page, the reference to Digna is there. Bhitti Chitra, the content, the fresco. And there is another thing which is not there, and that is called Gudra. Now, Gudra is not there because Gudra is the tattoo. So when you actually do a tattoo, it's called Gudna, G-U-D-N-A, G-U-D-N-A, Gudna. Now, these are all local dialects. And if you don't know the local dialects and if you go there, they will be completely surprised because they don't know the intricacies of modern nomenclatures. For them, it is Digna, Bhitti Chitra, Gudna, all these terms are more important. What is their art? What kind of art is Gond art? They say our art is khulla, open. So, you know, for them to put their art within panels is restrictive. For them, it is very difficult to restrict. So when they were doing Bhimayana, they were talking with Anand, who is basically the publisher of Navayana, also my friend. He was telling that it was very difficult for them to do things within a panel. For their art is khulla, their art is open, their art is always not bound by anything. So when they did Bhimayana, they kept it khulla. So, you know, the sequentiality in Bhimayana is not the Z-like sequentiality that you see in comics. So, if you look at a comics page, you can see that you normally move in a Z-like direction, right? Z-like direction. Okay, that is how your sequence moves. That is how your sequence is supposed to move. There may be variations, but this is the most common thing. But in Bhimayana, you cannot do that. Bhimayana, you can read everything at random. You can actually read from the bottom, from the top half, in the middle, right? You can plunge absolutely anywhere in the page because their art is khulla. Okay, and that is why Durga says that, you know, we cannot put it in boxes. We can only do it in khulla style. So that's a very, very interesting thing. Now, if you look at the art, let me talk a bit about the story behind the flourishing of Gond art in today's contemporary times. So there was this amazing personality, a genius you can call, whose name is Jhangar Singh Sham. And remember this name because he is the father of modern contemporary Gond art. Now, during 1980s, there was this amazing art critic called Jagdish Swaminathan. And in Bhopal, there was a new bhavan which was created that was supposed to curate art, tribal art, and it is called the Bharat Bhavan. Bharat Bhavan was made by Charles Coria. It's a beautiful place. And Jagdish was more interested in going to the village directly in order to take the art, you know, in order to take their art from there. So he sent scouts all over Madhya Pradesh and say, get me the best tribal art and let me go to the village and then you can have authentic kind of art. I don't want art which is imitated. And so he chanced upon this man called Jhangar Singh Sham in a village called Patangar. And it is under his guidance that Jhangar began to draw not on wall. He was the first Gond artist who used canvas, pen and paper. This was not done before. So it is Jhangar who was the one who first used paper or canvas as a matrix, not the wall. And Jhangar became extremely, extremely popular. Jhangar, of course, was exhibited in the Pompidou Center in Paris. He's there. If you go to Vidhan Sabha, you can see his paintings. He was taken to Japan. And there, people began to exploit him. Here is a very simple man. And I have one of the book, which is very, very interesting. This is a very thick book. I have, you know, 7-8 books on Jhangar. So this is, again, Jhangar's Tree of Life. And if you can see his art, you will be mesmerized. You just, you know, type Jhangar. He had to commit suicide because people took away his visa. They were not allowing him to return home. And he committed suicide in Japan. It was a strange end to one of the greatest artists India has ever produced. But what happened was, he produced a line of artists. So you look at Ram Singh Urveti, Subhash Vyam, the person who drew Vimayana, Venkat Raman Singh, Rajendra Shyam, Bhajju Shyam, Durga Bai, and you know that he has created a lineage. Now, one of the Gond poet whose name is Udayan Bajpayee, he christened, in a way, he named the art of Jhangar as Jhangar Kalam. Jhangar Kalam, because, you know, it is his style. So it is called Jhangar Kalam. And, you know, so the art that you see today is not, it's an evolved kind of art, not the art that the Gonds or the Pardhan Gonds used to paint on the walls. And that evolution came hand in hand with Jhangar. Of course, it's another thing that Subhash Vyam married Nankusai, who is actually, you know, one of the sisters of Jhangar. So they are also related. That doesn't make a huge difference, but it is more important, the ideological thing that, you know, Jhangar imparted to all the artists that followed him. So to every footnote of, you know, Gond art, you pay tribute to the inimitable Jhangar Singh Sham. Now, let me go a bit further and enter into Vimayana. You must be wondering what I'm trying to do. I hope you are not uninterested in all this, because I'll talk about Vimayana, don't worry. Now, if you look at their art is also very, what I call, symbolic. And this is also seen in Vimayana. When I actually look at Vimayana panel by panel, I will analyze that. But, you know, many times you can see that the art is anthropomorphized, you know, so, you know, animals are given human-like qualities, or even inanimate objects are, you know, given human-like qualities. In Vimayana, for example, this is done absolutely regularly. For example, a water well is crying. Now, a water well cannot cry, but it is actually given certain attributes, human attributes. So as if, you know, and even an inanimate object has what I call feelings. Now, this is what their art is all about. So their art is not cold. Their art is warm, full of feelings. Their art is what I call tactile. The best word is living art. And all their art is derived from the nature that they live in. And let me show you some of the patterns that they actually got inspired from nature. I think there is no way. So this is Narmada Tekam. Can you see this? Can everybody see this? Look at these wave-like patterns. Can you see that?
Yes, sir. Okay. Absolutely.
So this wave-like pattern for them is the lines from past to present. Past to present. So they are basically traces of memory. Okay? Wave-like memory. Next. Can you see this blue pattern? Can you see this pattern?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So this is a pattern from the thatched roof. Say they look at the thatched roof, and the thatched roof look like this. Now for them, it is also memory. It signifies memory because you weave thatched roofs, right? Similarly, you weave memory. Let us look at memory. Garlands, can you see? Garlands, they make garlands of rope, and they are also symbolic. They may stand for memory as well. So you can see, so this is actually Ram Singh Urvedi. Have you seen Kala Vyam? And you imagine why, from which, from this pattern is actually inspired from what? You'll be surprised. It is inspired from the muzzle, M-U-Z-Z-L-E, muzzle of a bull. Buller mukhe shamne je muzzle ta thake, tar pattern khub closely dekhle irakum or mone hoy. So that is from the muzzle of the bull that they develop this cross-hatched patterns. When they plow the field, can you see Ram Singh Urvedi? When you plow the field, you leave dots. Can you see? This is called the Goli and Bundi technique. And you see in Bhimayana, Durga Vyam has used the Goli and the Bundi. They are actually inspired from the plowed fields. So when you plow your fields, you leave dots. You till your soil and then you leave traces. And from there, you get the Goli and the Bundi technique. This is Nankusia Sham. I have talked about Nankusia. Can you understand from where this is inspired? According to Nankusia, this is inspired from processions, marriage processions that take place in the village. Here also, the Goli and the Bundi technique is in play. So you can understand that all their inspiration, okay, are from their lives, okay, from what they observe. And every animal that they depict has a symbolic function. For example, the entire world for them is Dharti Ma, Earth Mother. And Dharti Ma has Bada Dev and human beings and animals and inanimate objects all living together in a syncretic fashion. That is their world. That is what they are taught. That is what they are acquainted with. So unless you decode this world, how can you decode Vimayana? So what Vimayana does is they interestingly overlap the very ideology of this art with the ideology of Ambedkar, with the things that Ambedkar wants to talk about. And I will talk about that later. Let me also show you one very interesting work by Bhajju Shyam and then move on to Bhimayana. So let me show you Bhajju Shyam's work. Can you see my screen? Can you see my screen? Can you see my screen?
Yes, sir.
Okay, wonderful. But let me show you Bhajju Shyam's work. So there is this work called the London Jungle Book. You know, Bhajju went to London. He never went outside. He never went to a train, but he actually went to London to paint a restaurant. And even when he went to London, he can paint only with respect to his own iconography. So what he does, he transposes his worldview with what he sees in London. So for example, the London Jungle Book, this is his world. This is Bhajju's way of depicting this world. And look at teardrops filtering from his eye, falling from his eyes. So this is Bhajju's world, full of bullocks, the trees, and you see the umbilical cord. There is also a reference to Bhasha. Can you see the porcupine, the radio, the hull, the mango, the place, and which is all bound by, an umbilical cord. And this is Bhajju's world. This is Bhajju's world. And what happened is he's traveling by train and then by plane. The airport is like an eagle. Can you see? It's spread out. And then you take the plane like the Airabat, okay, the elephant, which lifts up. It is heavy yet light. Look at the way the elephant is drawn. The tail of the elephant is like a snake. So it is as if the snake is propelling the elephant to leap up. So these are small things that you need to be careful about. And then when he reaches London, how does he depict London? The underworld of London for him is the underworld of his own soil. So he depicts the London Metro as an earthworm. Can you see King's Cross is referred to? And it's a crisscross of many, earthworm-like creatures traveling within the ground. So whenever you see the London double-decker bus, it's like a dog because it is faithful and it always arrives on time. So when you see a London food habits, he actually, because it is so, everybody eats everything. So it is like an octopus, because like an octopus, it's omnivorous. It takes in everything that it sees. And of course, the London pub, the nightlife of London. What is the better way to talk about nightlife, by depicting the Londoners as bats, and the bats on a mohua tree, since they are drinking. So the bats are upside down in a mohua tree. That's the way he depicts nightlife. So, this is the way. The best part is, of course, the Big Ben. The Big Ben is transposed into the cock that he faces in the morning. Okay, that he encounters in the morning in his own village. So, this is the world of Gond art that you need to talk about. This is what the world is like. So keep all these things in mind when we go to talk about Bhimayana. Because unless you know how things are transposed, how things are overlapped, how the ideology of their art is used to talk about a real ideology that talks about the margins, you can never understand Bhimayana completely, because it is about Ambedkar. It is as much about Ambedkar as about another kind of art, which also resides in the margins, the Gond art. The Gond art is not in the mainstream. So in order to talk about Ambedkar, who is trying to talk about the margins, it's trying to bring the margins to the fore, you are using art which is also marginalized in Indian iconography, Indian painting history, the Gond art. It is such a rich form of art, yet you do not pay attention to it the way you should. Now, what is Bhimayana? all about. Now let us go to Bhimayana, because if I now don't go to Bhimayana, people will leave my lecture, because ultimately this is also about Bhimayana. So when you talk about Bhimayana, and can you see this? Can you see the cover? Can you see the cover of Bhimayana? Everybody? Hello?
Yes, sir. Absolutely.
Okay, wonderful. I hope you are not bored. Are you bored? I mean, if I'm bored, I just go straight to Bhimayana.
It's out of the question, sir. We actually spend on
so... You are only answering for others. Okay. Yes, sir, you are bored? No, sir, you are. No, I'm not getting it. So, but anyway, I hope you don't get bored. I know this is a bit different from your world, but this is also a world you need to enter into in order to understand Bhimayana. So when you look at Bhimayana, of course, when we talk about Ambedkar specifically, there has been depiction of Ambedkar in comics earlier, notably, of course, the Amar Chitra Katha, ACK depiction. And that depiction is extremely problematic. In fact, the very idea of, the ideology of Amar Chitra Katha, ACK, is extremely problematic, because it also doesn't question, certain things. It takes for granted certain things related to nationalism, related to the idea of nationhood, which is sometimes too glib, I think too odd, if you do not question things, it doesn't sound right. So I'm not going to ACK's depiction of Ambedkar. Let us talk about Bhimayana. Now, if you look at the Bhimayana, first of all, the font of Bhimayana is not available commercially. The font is developed by the publication house Navayana, and they renamed, it's a kind of a handwritten font, not exactly handwritten, it is handwritten but generated. It looks like a handwritten font, and they call the font Bhim, of course, in memory of Bhimrao Ambedkar. And so this is a new font. So they create a unique font for the book. Now, if you go to the book particularly, let us study what the contents of the book is all about. What is the book all about? Okay. Now, if you look at the book, it is divided into certain parts. So you can see there is a foreword by John Berger, the great John Berger, who wrote Ways of Seeing, one of the most important texts that you can follow. And then there is a short prefatory section called One Day, followed by three books or three chapters: Water, Shelter, Travel. Now, water is, of course, all these parts are actually taken from volume 12 of Ambedkar's collected works, Waiting for Visa. Now, there are certain episodes which are added within the text, which are not in Waiting for Visa. What are those episodes? The Mahad Satyagraha. Okay, that is, of course, added because it is such an important part of Ambedkar's life. Then Gandhi Ambedkar confrontation at the Round Table conference of 1931-32, that is also added. That is not there in Waiting for Visa. Ambedkar's conversion to Buddhism is alluded to or referred to. That is also added. And lastly, the drafting of constitution by Ambedkar is also added to the narrative. So except these four things, all the anecdotes, the stories that you face are all in Waiting for Visa, which is basically volume 2 of Ambedkar's definitive collected works. Now, volume 1 is about water. One Day is a very contemporary take. So, you have to understand, although the book is about Ambedkar, it is also not only about Ambedkar. It is also about the ramifications of caste politics in today's India. So there are many episodes. All these big episodes, Water, Shelter, Travel, are intercut by references to contemporary newspaper cuttings or news items related to violence on the Dalits. For example, the preface, in a way, not a preface, but like a preface, the whole chapter, One Day, is set in contemporary India. And it doesn't talk about Ambedkar. It talks about two people arguing with each other regarding quota system. It's like a conversation. It's like a debate or a conversation. So, you know, the entire book travels into the past, but never ever forgets the presentness, the relevance of the debates set in motion almost 50-60 years before by Ambedkar. So what is very interesting, One Day is a very, it's set in contemporary times, and it talks about two people who will converse or debate about the quota system. And while talking about the quota system, one of the persons, a girl, will try to tell the other person the story of Ambedkar. Not the entire story of Ambedkar, but some parts of the stories of Ambedkar. Look at the subtitle, Experiences of Untouchability. So it's not about, it's Bhimayana. Of course, first of all, the title is an ironical nod to Ramayana. Ram, as you all know, is an upper caste icon, alien icon. So in order to subvert or put a kind of ironic counterpart to the very idea of Ramayana, this is called Bhimayana, Ramji Ambedkar, so Bhimayana. And very, very interestingly, it's, the subtitle is called Experiences of Untouchability. Now, so it's not about the life of Ambedkar. It is actually about the vignettes in the life of Ambedkar. So it is more episodic in nature rather than anything else. So what is very, very important is, Ambedkar is important here, is the protagonist here, but this is not only about Ambedkar. It is more about the ideology of Ambedkar, what Ambedkar is talking about, whether they are relevant today, how they are relevant today. Of course, they are relevant, but how they are relevant, in what way, in what manner. Okay, so what happened 50 years ago can actually take place even today. Okay, so these are the things that you need to talk about. So the chapter Water is about the denial of water to a little Ambedkar when he was a child at a school, only because he was an untouchable. So people will drink water from the pond, even animals will drink water from the pond, but the young Ambedkar, who is thirsty, will not be able to drink water purely because he's an untouchable. Okay. The second part is shelter. Remember, it is the story of hostilities that Ambedkar faced when he came back to settle in Baroda, Baroda. And the hostilities were faced mostly from the Brahmins and the Parsis. So again, these are basic amenities, right? You are denied water, you are denied shelter merely because of caste. And last is travel. And the travel also talks about that kind of experience of exclusion. So before we go into the text proper, so now we know the structure of the text, let me analyze the text one by one. So when you go to the text, first of all, see how the hand, look at the cover. Have you seen the cover? And if you look at the cover, you can see that blue forms a very important part of the cover. And if you look at the upper part of the cover, the goli and the bundi technique has been used. The wave-like pattern, the thatch-like pattern is used, upon which the name Bhimayana is written in a wave-like pattern, almost denoting a kind of a memory strand that this person may evoke in our lives. This person, Bhimrao Ramji Ambedkar. Now look at the use of colors. You have saffron and green, of course, the colors of Indian flag, but they are also colors of earth and greenery, color of nature. And the hand is actually in the foreground while the faces are in the background. It is the upraised hand. Look at the way. I hope you can see. Can you see this? Can you see the red line? Can you see the way?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Can you see the way the vertical, the diagonal line cuts across the cover almost as a symbol of protest? So the entire cover is very ordered until this line almost cuts it, not into half, but into one third of it. And it's cut diagonally. So Ambedkar's story with his upraised hand, you know, pointing fingers, is a story of resistance. It's a story that actually tries to talk about protests, about the way resistance can be organized, not only physically, but also can be implanted in the mindscape of people. Look at this very, very small, you know, can you see? There are small woman figures. Have you ever given it a notice? So Ambedkar's, you know, body or his shirt or whatever is full of those figures which represent the people that he's talking about. So he's actually not about a person. It is all about the aspirations, the hope of the people about whom he is protesting, about whom he is almost trying to talk about. And then if you go to the next page, the dedicatory page, remember I talked about Jhangar Singh Shyam. Have you seen that? Remember I talked about this artist called Jhangar Singh Shyam. Can you see that? This is dedicated to Jhangar Singh Shyam, to the memory of Jhangar Singh Shyam. I've talked about this art called Jhangar Kalam. Now, this is an amazing portrait. This is almost like a cross section of a man. If you do the cross section of a frog, it is as if a man, the gut of a man is opened. And within the gut, you have every kind of living and non-living being. So you have art objects, you have animals, you have inanimate objects like the plow, everything playing within in his body scape. So Jhangar is a repository of memory. So if this is about Ambedkar, it is also about Jhangar, a man who was also ostracized, a man who had to face tragedy because he was from the margins of the society, despite being a genius artist. Now, this is something that I find very, very exciting. Now, once you go into the first part, let me show you. This is the Digna. Remember, I talked about the Digna. Can you see my red line? Can everybody see my red line? Can you see my red line?
Yes, sir, we can.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so this is the Digna. So this is the separator. Remember, in a comics, what we have? In a comics, we have boxes, right? Like, don't we have boxes? You normally read from like this, right? Z pattern. Can you see this small? So in comics, these are called panels. These boxes are called panels. So you move from one panel to another. That is how you move in the narrative sequence of the comics. Now in Gondart, since their art is Khulla, they move across the Digna. So the narrative is across the Digna, but very, very difficult is to read in a particular pattern. Now this also shows the multifarious points of entry that you can take while reading this. So you can read from here, you can read from here, you can read this first, and then you can read this. So any part of the of this page can be read at any point of time, unlike in a normalized comics panel where you read according to a sequence. So here is a story where you can pick up the story from any place that you like. Now, this multiple entry points also gives you a kind of freedom, the freedom of Khulla. And once you note the freedom, you understand what Gond art really talks about. Gond art cannot get what I called suppressed within the panels, which are very artificial in nature, which is very a Western construct, remember? So Gond art creates his own panel. For example, these are, look at the Digna in the next page. So in the next page, you have another Dignas. Can you see the Dignas are different? Can you see? The patterns are different. The pattern here is this. Can you see the pattern is this? And can you see the pattern is more like this, thread-like? Now these are news items, newspaper items. Look at the date, 29 October 9206. This is actually the about the Khairlanji massacre, which happened in 2006. So if Ambedkar was tortured, if Ambedkar was excluded for being a Dalit or an untouchable in pre-independent India, what is the difference today? Nothing has changed. So, you know, you transpose the story of Ambedkar with a more contemporary news items. Look at this, is an item from 2010, and here that there is the call, the rape of Kolhapur. Look at that assault of, so you know, they take the small stories that you ever see even in today's newspaper about Dalit atrocities, about untouchability. We haven't progressed really, because you know, it's still the untouchables play a role. Why even in this century, I mean, we haven't been able to come out of that, what I call entrapment. So what is very, very important here is the way the story of Ambedkar is foregrounded. So unlike a normal biography, this is not a biography. This is a story about the vignettes of Ambedkar's life, which teaches us about something. It begins with a scene in a bus stop. Now look at the way the first scene is done. So in a bus stop, can you see the whole picture? Can you see the picture on the right hand side? Can everybody see?
Yes sir.
So is this interesting? If it is interesting, I will explain a bit more. Are you all interested in hearing all these? I mean, I'm not too sure.
Yes sir, very much excited also.
Okay, very, very good. So if you are really liking it, fantastic. So look at the bus stop. The bus stop is not just an inanimate thing, right? A bus stop, it's like a shade, right? Everything. But here, the woman is the bus stop. Can you see? The woman with the hair is the shade of the bus stop. Can you see that? And within the bus stop, so the bus stop is, tell me. Do you want to tell me anything? The woman in the bus stop is anthropomorphized into a woman with extended hair, and one man and a girl and a woman are arguing. Now look at the road, and they are waiting in the bus stop, and when they are waiting in the bus stop, they are discussing about quota system. Now the man is telling, super qualified, but I am stuck in a dead-end job. That's my life. I blame those damn job quotas for backward and scheduled castes. It isn't fair. But look at the speech balloon. This is called a speech balloon. So in a comics, say when anybody, say for example, this man, let me draw this man. This man is speaking. Hi. So this will be called a speech balloon. If this man is thinking, this will be called a thought balloon. Look at the way the speech balloons are used. Even they are like characters, animal characters. So this speech balloon is like a bird. Can you see? Can you see? Can you see?
Yes, sir, we can. We can.
So this speech balloon is like a bird. And sir, this balloon, yes, tell me. Okay. And this speech balloon is like a sting of a scorpion. Can you see? So it signifies the state of mind. This man is angry. This woman is reasonable. So when she is reasonable, she talks in a free manner with logic. That is why the speech balloon is like a bird. When the man is angry, his words carry a sting with it. And that is why it is like a scorpion, the tail of a scorpion. So even the speech balloon, so if you look at the speech balloons, you can easily make out which is the tone of the speech. So this is, look, the sting of a scorpion, this is more like a bird. And sometimes when there are captions, they are done within elaborate digna. So this is very, very exciting. And so look at the stings. Can you see the stings? Can you see? So for example, let me give you more examples across the text. So, sir, the peon won't give me water. Ambedkar is telling. The sir is very angry and is actually stinging like a thing. So look, anything that stings, anything that is talked about in anger, has a scorpion like end. This is very, very interesting. So what I'm trying to say that even the smallest details are part of what you call life as art and art as life. This is what is called living art. This is not art which just looks beautiful. This is not art which is just aesthetically satisfying. This is art as part of your life. This is art as part of nature. This is art as part of your ecosystem. And this is art as part of the whole cosmos. So if you look at the way this is done, this is very exciting. Look at the use of eyes. Now, whenever you are pointing out something, within that, eyes, anatomical fragments of eyes are placed within. Why? Because if you are not only, so you are, you, the author wants you to look at these, okay? But the author wants you to look at these with open eyes. So it's not as if you are looking at the entire thing in a very inanimate manner. You have to open your eyes. Just pointing direction doesn't make sense. It is only when you open your eyes, then what you are looking at makes sense. So the use of eyes within the hands are also in a way symbolic of what I call an open mind, an openness with which you need to view things. Look at the page marks. Have you seen the page mark below? See the page mark. The tails of a fish. Can you see? Can you see at below page 14, tails of a fish? So this is very, very exciting that, even the page marks are the tails of a fish. They're just like the margins of the fish, the fins of the fish, they form a triangle, an invisible triangle, within which the numbers are nestled. Now, let us look at one part of the book. And this is very, very exciting. Before I go into that, the water section, let me also show you something before I go into this. Durga Vyam, before he drew this, also drew this. This is called water. Ulto dikke dekhale bodhay bhalo hobe na. How do I see it? Okay, can you see it? Can you make out? This is a book called Water. So when he actually did it, Durga, the Subhash Bhayam and Durga Vyam actually drew water. Can you see? Very complex images related to water. So the water imagery, the water motif is employed in many ways by both. This is by Subhash Bhayam, Subhash and Durga. Okay, so when you look at the chapter Water, you immediately remember this book by Subhash called Water. This is published by Tara Books, one of the pioneers of what I call this kind of books. Let me show you another picture and then go to again the look at this. Look at the powerful imagery that Subhash creates with water. Now, what is water? What does water signify? What exactly do you imply when you draw water in a particular way? Let me again share my screen. Please confirm whether you can see my screen. Can you all see my screen? Just confirm. Yes or no? Simple word. Can you see the screen?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Wonderful.
Yes, sir.
Wonderful. Now look at this chapter. This is a story of Satara. Remember, that is the place where young Ambedkar was born. And it's a story in the school life of Ambedkar. And you can see that there he was denied water. Why? Because he was a Dalit, or he was an untouchable. He was somebody who was excluded from the natural activities of the school. So look at the way, can you see this picture? A thirsty Ambedkar. Look at the water. There is a fish within. Can you see? Can you see the fish within Ambedkar?
Yes, sir.
Wonderful.
Yes,
so
sir.
What does the fish do? The fish is making you feel thirsty. So Ambedkar is asking, sir, may I drink some water? Bhim, always a nuisance. Can't you wait until the bell rings? When the bell rings, all the other students go to the tap. By the time they finish, the peon has gone home and I'm not supposed to touch the tap. Well, naturally, you are a Mahar. If you cut your hair more often, you will feel less thirsty. You look as if there are no barbers in Satara. Then, but doesn't he know? Barbers won't touch us, Mahar. Look at the teardrops. So, I have read it in a very dramatic fashion. Look at the way this is like, can you see? This is very much like a bird. This is sting of a tail. So, you know, I have modulated my voice and I've read the entire piece according to the tonality depicted within the graphic representation of speech. This is the key to reading Bhimayana. Now, what happened is then all the people are drinking water and you can see the village tube well is like a woman. Even she is feeling for Ambedkar. He is excluded from this group. So this is a picture of exclusion. And this is the thing. And when Ambedkar comes, in angry tone, the peon says, off you go. I cannot give you water. And then a stunning color panel where Ambedkar sees that in the pond, even the animals are drinking water, but you cannot drink water purely because you are an untouchable. And this shakes young Ambedkar. And this is beautiful. There is a beautiful look at the way a poem from Dalit literature has been inserted. This is from Namdev Dhasal's poem called water. Remember, Namdev Dhasal is part of Dalit Panther movement. And Dilip Chitre has translated it from Marathi. The heart of the water is generous and reaches the very roots. Its healing touch makes the scabs of a thousand sorrows fall upon walls. How many walls can you build around water? How will you shackle the rushing form of water? These are simple questions, but questions that agitate Bhim Rao. You know, remember Tagore talking of narrow domesticated walls? This is the narrowest kind of domesticated wall that you can construct. You are denying even water because you belong to a different caste. Remember Chandalika? You remember, these are all very much there. But very, very interesting is the way this panel, so if you look at the entire panel, this is like a petal. So you can read this first. So you can read this first or this first or this first or this first. It doesn't matter. And the entire, this panel is like a fish. So, you know, even the shape of the page changes as you go, as you move. And, you know, how do you explain this? So what happens was, even 2 weeks later, when they go, when they travel another place with their father and they look at the place, he sees that, you know, everything is so full of life, so full of color. But these people, you know, they, the Mahars, they are denied even the basic amenities of life. And this, why this is so important, is the way the visuals are almost like shorthands for metaphor of untouchability. It's almost like the chapter of the water. You can see what happens. Ambedkar became the eye of the fish. He becomes the fish. He becomes the fish, and he became the repository of water. So Ambedkar himself becomes a fish, and he contains within himself water, knowledge. Of course, knowledge as water, water is knowledge. And from where every untouchable can drink. You understand? So look at the way the narrative moves. So there is no depiction of pond. You could have easily depicted a pond, but you depict Ambedkar as the fish. Of course, the small figure of Ambedkar is the eye of the fish. He guides, and with the fish contains the villages, the hutments, and it also contains everybody who can drink water from this repository. This is beautiful. The metamorphosis of the image, the imagery, the motif of water. So even the last part, remember, we go back to the woman and the man. And there you can see again an ecosystem of water being drawn, but with a tree. The tree of life. Water is life. Water is everything. But remember, water is also knowledge. Water is also openness. Water is also something, a medium, a fluid medium, which lets you think. So one day, the very water that is denied to Ambedkar becomes the medium through which you can convey lucidly what he is trying to inculcate. Similarly, you can explain, you know, things like shelter, you can explain everything. You know, I can just go on and on and on because this takes a lot of time. I'll just show you one thing. You know, look at the way thought balloons are repressed. Look here, you don't have stings, you have small, what I call thought, you know, references, but they are all in form of an eye. So you are basically thinking with an open mind. That is what it's being talked about. So whenever you read Bhimayana, you can talk about caste politics, you can talk about the politics of the text, but it is very, very important to understand. That's a very easy way to do it because that is the content of the text. But more than that, it is important to understand that the politics of the text is also driven by the politics of the art. And unless you understand that part, I don't think you will be able to decode this piece very well. Let us go to this panel. I think one of the best panels. Again, look at the two pages, the spreads. You can see that the contemporary news from 2008, where Dalit siblings are thrashed by the landlord. Again, a reference to shelter because they are not given shelter. And look what Ambedkar's face become. Remember, Ambedkar become a fish there. Here, Ambedkar becomes the earth. Earth which contains everything. Ambedkar's face contains people playing. He becomes a playground. He becomes the earth. He becomes the Dharti Ma. He becomes the entire cosmos on which everybody plays. Everybody can actually have a free go. So what is beautifully done here is the way Ambedkar's body gets transformed. Various, you know, Ambedkar's, the very idea of Ambedkar is transposed by converting the body or parts of Ambedkar's physicality to a symbol, to an overarching, what I call Bhittichitra matrix. So this is very, very important. You go to travel, similar things happen. And if you look at the way the travel chapter is full of color, and you can easily see that even in the travel chapter, you know, there are many things that you also need to know. For example, look at the Dalits. Dalits are almost represented by elephants, fish, and all that. Whenever they face resistance, you know, the animals are more angry. They are lion-like, they are fierce, they are crocodiles. So, you know, the upper class Brahmins and everybody who are antagonists to the Dalits, they are represented in a more fierce, wild manner. That is also there. So if you go to travel, there also you will see there is one page which is extremely didactic. And this is again a kind of a episode which was not there in Waiting for Visa, the Gandhi Ambedkar debate. And if you look at the division of the page, Ambedkar is on the left hand side, Gandhi is on the right hand side. So one hand you have Ambedkar, so you split almost down the middle of the film, just like any other novel or any other book. You need to create an ecosystem within which you can actually read the text. So it is very, very important to understand. It is very, very important to understand that unless you read decode Vibhayana in the way that I have taught you, that's of course not the only way, but at least with an intimation of what these art really means, it becomes extremely difficult to contextualize this discourse. Okay, this is where I end my lecture. And I have just taken, I think 1 hour, 20 minutes or something like that, to explain a bit of it. I mean, of course, I just can give you a small preview. Normally, when I teach, I take a month or maybe 1.5 months to teach because I can explain each and every panel separately. But one thing I must end by when I talk about my lecture, my experience of Pathankar is amazing. And I must tell you, if you ever go to Pathankar to visit there and see the work of art from close quarters, and I'll say you will never ever miss it. It's a once in a lifetime experience. So thank you, everybody. If there are any questions, there are maybe many. Oh, there are 121 chats. It's like, oh gosh, amazing. How many? Oh, these are mostly yes. So that's fine. So if there are any questions, if there are foolish questions, and I particularly love the foolish questions, if there are questions that you fear to ask your teachers, you can always ask me, because I'm not a teacher, I'm just a friend. So you know, you can always ask me, and I'm always ready to answer it in whatever way I can, in whatever small way I can. I hope Madhumita Di, Ahona, and all the other teachers, and you know, if there are any, and the students, maybe have just didn't get bored. You know, that much I can tell. And of course, you know, there are many ways in which you can get bored. Imagine that this is another way of getting bored, you know. So let me go to questions if there are any. I hope you have liked it. I don't know. I wait till you're
ready. Sir, could I take a minute to speak? Anand, I'm taking a minute.
Tell me.
Good evening, sir. I happen to be one of the faculty members.
Oh, wow.
Yes. Yes, sir. I had the privilege of hearing you before at the DRS seminar, if you remember. Your speech was scheduled on Calcutta University, Talipur campus. Was on
Satyajit Ray. Yes.
Yeah,
yes,
and
yes.
You had spoken of the Bohus movement there. So that had actually made me look forward to this session today. And once again, sir, it has been such a privilege to hear you. And again, it's very unfortunate that we can't claim more of your time, because you said you take months to teach this, and the little you have enlightened us with, I mean, it's unfortunate that we cannot know more.
I must tell you, Jakia, thank you so much. But one of the reasons I can tell you so much more, because I have firsthand experience of these artists. Okay, so that helps, I think. That's probably one privilege I have as an artist. Remember, I'm also a practicing artist, not a Gond artist, but of course an artist. So that helps me.
Yes, sir. That is why it is quite natural on our part to lament that we cannot know more from you because of the time.
You are all fantastic teachers, because if you teach the things to video text in a proper way, even that helps. Now, this can always be supplementary. My approach is to approach the text from a more visual perspective, because this is visual, right? But even if you approach the text from the other perspective, it is not bad. It is actually perfect. It is fine, because there are many ways of doing this. My way is different from yours, but that doesn't lessen your way. That is what I'm trying to tell.
Thank you nonetheless, sir. Anandi, carry on.
Okay, thank you, Jakia. Madhumita Di?
Yes, I'm here.
Please don't call me sir.
Actually, I fall short of words. What I want to say to you is that, as usual, I also, you know, by the way, let me tell you. First of all, I listened to your lecture in Adamas University, in which you spoke on the graphic novel as such.
Yes, just an introduction. Yeah.
So, as usual, let me tell you that I'm enthralled. And another challenge is lying before me, before I thank you properly. that is, I have to think at least 100 times before, if the college opens sometime from here.
Yes,
so
yes.
I have to sit before the students to teach this Vimayana with lots of puzzles in my head, because I'm just washed away. And I don't know what I will do with the text.
You can teach it. You just go your way. Because, you know, my way is a bit, because it's more an artist's take. Although I equate it with a bit more.
Okay, now we as a department would like to welcome you always, the sooner we get well and go back to our original habitat.
Yes,
so we won't leave you.
Thank you. I have been there, so it's not as if I don't know the place. I know Chagda.
No, I haven't seen it in our department.
No, Chagda te jaini, mane college e jaini. Of course, I didn't go to the college. I went to the place, Chagda. Of course, Chagda.
Before Ahuna resumes,
Chagda mane Nodia Chagda to. I've been Chagda.
আমি সব সময় নীলচানের ওই কথাটা ভীষণ বিশ্বাস করি. Those also serve who stand and wait. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Madhumita Di. One of the problems was I couldn't give you a date. one of the reasons was I was talking left and right. And
I know.
And that is the problem. I'm trying to shut down a bit. But
and you know, we were, even Ahona was in a fix how to tell you, because this
is I gave a lecture. I thought that was the end of it. And then she said, no, you have to give another one. I said, okay. Because you, Madhumitadi was talking, you know, telling so many times. It was very difficult for me to say no. Absolutely. When I'm always for, you know, delivering to students, because I can always deliver to an August audience. But that's not the problem. The problem is to actually converse to the students, because they are much more intelligent. They are much more receptive than people who just sit there and do nothing. I mean, I love, you know, talking with students more than anybody else.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Feel free. Je kota question na
amar kono byapar nai golper
moto kore na feel free khub beshi question na niye ahona ami tomake bolchi je student ra pore jodi proshno ara thake they can go further mane kichu representative questions jodi newa jay ar ki so because he has talked a lot
kichu ekhane ache tumra keu kichu bolbe ki you can unmute yourself and maybe and then mute যেটা একবার যদি আনমিউট করে তোমাদের কিছু বলার থাকে কোনো কোয়েশ্চেন সেটাও করতে পারো ডাইরেক্ট ভয়ের কিছু নেই বোকা বোকা প্রশ্ন করতে পারো কারণ আমি নিজে জীবনে সবসময় বোকা বোকা প্রশ্ন করতাম
বোকা বোকা প্রশ্ন তো স্যার বোধহয় আমি করব আমি আবার বোকা বোকা প্রশ্ন
করতে ওকে ডু দ্যাট
আগে আগে স্টুডেন্টদের প্রশ্নগুলো একবার একটুখানি দেখি হ্যাঁ Shoyoma Shengupta, she asks, from the painting of the Tree of Life, which had straight lines on it without a tinge of extravagant colors, is it that the Gonds believed on a disciplined pattern of life?
That's a fantastic, actually, you are right. It's not about discipline, I'll say order of life. So they have actually what he called a kind of an order. And for them, everything is related to each other. So every part, so have you seen the pattern of the thatched roof? You know, it's all related to each other. So you basically, you know, weave everything together. So, you know, every part of the universe is part of a whole. Okay, so they believe in what I call the order. One of my friends, the great Gond artist is Venkat Shyam, is a very good friend of mine and told me that Pinaki, our life, you know, nothing can fall out of pattern. You know, for us, everything has what I call a pattern, an existence in a particular place. And that is because the Gond believe in a bigger system, cosmic system of order. And that's not a very hierarchical thing, but it's more of a cosmic system. It's a kind of a contemplative philosophy, okay, about oneness of life. I think that is why you are very right that they believed in a pattern, but discipline not only in life, but also in the way they philosophically arrange themselves. Okay. There was some kind of worldly, yes, worldly painting is different. Worldly, of course, is another kind of painting. But you are right. I think Piali Bishash talked about Pottochitra, and worldly painting was also talked about by, I saw it.
Yes, this is, let me check.
Uttimagarai. So basically, both of them are right. They are different things, but of course, they are all part of indigenous arts. Yeah. Anything more?
Yes, sir. There are two more questions. Prantika asks, though this has been addressed, still the question
the symbolic
is...
Symbolic meaning of the clock.
The symbolic meaning of the clock, yes.
Okay, so wonderful. The clock, of course, refers to time, refers to not only time, but refers to the idea of memory, to the past, to the present, and to the present of the future. So, you know, the clock is a kind of a marker, you know, marker of time as you move from the past to the present and the future. So what is very, very important is, you know, the clock is a real time marker, but you are actually talking of time as something of a continuum, you know, so time begins from who knows where and doesn't end anywhere. So it's like a continuum on which clock is just a marker. So you cannot talk about anything called the present, because the present is always in the past, and for example, this sound is now in the present. No, it's not in the present, it's called in the past. So there is nothing called presentness. So what is time? What is clock? Clock is a marker of what is past, with respect to what can be present and what can be future. So I think clock is a marker of time more than anything else. But time is continuum. It's continuous. It's part of a cosmic whole.
All right, yes,
there is also Ambedkar was on the left side. I really don't know. I don't know why he's in the left side, but of course you can understand that he's on the different side of the picture. So Gandhi is on the right side, Ambedkar is on the left side. I really don't know whether there is a significance on that. I really don't. Frankly, I really don't know. But I don't think it is more important to understand that they are facing each other. They are like a binary split. That part is more important. Okay, I think that is more important here rather than who is in the left and the right, because the left and right doesn't mean anything in that sense. You know, doesn't signify anything. That much I know. I mean, there may be some stuff, but I don't know.
All right. So the next questions all actually ask you about the train, the significance of the train, the depiction of the
before
train.
Before that, there is Prashomita Sarkar. Who writes that the page numbers has been written in a triangle shape. Remember the page, kind of a tension between the schedule of the train, which should be like dogs, that they should be very loyal, they should always arrive on time, but they don't because their wheels are like reptiles and they move very slowly. So there is a kind of a dichotomy in the way both the animals are integrated symbolically within the ecosystem of that ritual. You understand what I'm trying to tell?
So Prashomita, are you satisfied with Sa's answer?
Yeah, got it. She wrote. Got it.
Okay. Okay. Joita
animal said is of course that's a dog. So I think the same question, right? Anik Mondal. Sometimes yes, mostly it's a dog. Same question. What does the picture of wheels in 47? So I have to look at the wheels. 47 is of course if you look at the wheels in 47, 47 or 37? 37, right?
Yes.
Page 37, right? So if you look at the page 37, you will see, and this is very, very interesting, the wheels actually are bigger than the people. So it is the wheels that are more important than the people themselves, which are very, very interesting. So the wheels are, in a way, they are also, you know, they also signify movement. They signify progress. They signify a forward movement. So, you know, the bullock cart is all wheels rather than, they have the bullock, but the wheel is given prominence. You know, the travelers, the passengers are not given prominence at all. But in a way, it is also very ironic, because if you look at the word progress, not only as movement, but as, you know, openness, you know, it is actually a regress, because even the bullock cart, you can easily understand that the people who is driving the bullock cart is not too happy when he discovers that the passenger he carries are basically untouchables. So he leaves them. So you have to understand that somehow the wheels are, in a way, a kind of an ironic comment on the idea of progress. And if you look at the travel section, you know, wheels are regularly referred to. Wheels emerge as a motive, and they are not always are a positive motive. They are always integrated in such a way that they are also sometimes depicted in a negative manner. Not in a negative manner, in an ironic manner, in a subversive manner. So that may be one of the reasons. You know, wheels are accentuated. They are given prominence. It may be an ironic undercutting of the very idea of progress, because we haven't progressed. We think we have progressed. Wheel is, of course, a symbol of progress, but we haven't. That's what we are talking about. I hope I have answered. I don't know whether I have really answered you, but this is what I thought of. Okay.
So sir, I have a silly question in stock.
Tell me.
Something very quite silly, you might find. Okay. As we move from the first section, first chapter, water to shelter, we find a very, blue, the tints of blue gets darker, kind of purplish. Is it any sort of, does it signify anything?
Yeah, the blue, of course, is also the color of Ambedkar. Remember the Dalit movement, if you look, blue is very much a color of the Dalits. You know, it has got a specific significance. And, you know, the darker shade of blue is, of course, the way it, the blue becomes philosophically much more cohesive. So, you know, as Ambedkar is moving, you know, in life, as he's moving, evolving in philosophy, I think the blue becomes darker. It becomes much more cohesive. Now, what is very, very important is, of course, blue was a favorite color of Ambedkar. Remember, in fact, he was very much, remember when he actually made a flag of the party, remember, Ambedkar Scheduled Caste Federation of India in 1942, he actually used the color blue. In fact, so it's very, very important to understand that blue is the color of sky. It actually shows the vastness. In a way, it's also the way Ambedkar wants to talk about his vision. You know, his vision is not something that is constricted. His vision is not something that is, that is narrow. His vision embraces the entireness of sky. So the sky grows darker means, of course, his philosophy is also getting much more, what I call, organized. And that is why the shade also becomes a bit more dark. And remember, all the shades, the tonality of the shades have specific symbolic meaning to it. Definitely. Definitely. They, you know, these things are so much there in the text. You know, every color has a point to make. That's what I personally feel. So this is my take, purely my take.
Sir, another question popped up from Biraj. Would I say?
Yeah.
He asks, sir, would you say something on discrimination relating any picture of
the entire work is on discrimination. But you know, one thing is to talk about discrimination and one thing is to depict discrimination. You know, it is very easy to talk about discrimination. You can give a lecture on discrimination, but how do you depict discrimination visually? Imagine the way, young Ambedkar was denied water. So he is actually in the far corner of the page and everybody is actually occupying the center of the page. So the very idea of, you know, denoting Ambedkar at the margin of the page is taken literally and metaphorically. And that is again discrimination. So you can always say that he is discriminated against, but how do you show that he is discriminated against? That's the question. So the everything in the novel is actually to foreground the discrimination faced by the Dalits in India, by untouchables in India, within quote, of course, these are not my words, but this is very, very interesting. This is very, very interesting because I must tell you, one thing is to talk about discrimination. Another thing is to show them in real life, in visuals, through visuals. And that is what he does. So, of course, every picture, everything, I haven't shown you everything, but every picture can actually talk about discrimination in different ways. And that is what the entire Bhimayana work is trying to do. Bhimayana and Ramayana, there is something by Masood Mandal who says that what is the difference? Of course, Ramayana is actually an upper caste epic. It's you can know Aryan epic, you know, Aryan epic. Although there are other versions as well, but we tend to read it as a kind of a epic of Aryan superiority. Ram is frequently talked about as a man of Aryan superiority. He's an icon, right? In a very different way. Now, what is Bhimayana? So Ramayana is being ironically subverted and talked about in Bhimayana. So you take Yana. Yana is, of course, the tail. Ram's tail becomes Bhim's tail. So Ambedkar. So in a way, you are constructing a new myth, not the myth of Ramayana, but, you know, like the myth of Ramayana, this is also a very important counter myth, the counter myth of a real person. Not a person who is mythological. That's why Bhimayana. So it's a very ironic idea. So that, yes, there is a relation, and the relation is irony. To create the irony between the term Ramayana and Bhimayana.
And so there's one more question. Perhaps this is the last one.
I think this is a fantastic question. Why some pages are colorful and some are not? I mean, it can take a 40 minutes to explain it. But yes, they are symbolic. So some pages are colorful. I cannot explain it to you right now, but when there is color, there is symbol, because color is another dimension to Gondart. So whenever you have a normal Gondart without any color, it signifies something. But whenever color is added, and remember, I give you a list of natural extracts from which the colors are derived. Haven't I given you the list? So whenever you give color, you add another level of meaning. So very important to understand that the colored pages have another level of meaning, which the black and white page don't have. So they add to it. Now, if you want me to explain it, I will take another hour, which we don't have, but maybe one day I will do that. But very, very interesting. We have actually noted it, and fantastically noted. You are right. Color is there. Color is very important. It adds another level. It is symbolic. Definitely symbolic. I'm not answering his question because it will take a huge amount of time. But he is right. He is absolutely right. At this rate, I need to write a book on... Yeah, tell me.
Sorry for intruding.
Tell me. Tell me, Shubhra.
Yeah, thank you. First of all, good evening, everyone, and it's been a real pleasure to have listening to you. It's been, I have heard loads of you, like all good things, and today I really got this opportunity to, you know, to listen to you.
Tell me something bad about me. I am very bored with good things.
Then I have to invent that, because I haven't heard anything bad. And I would not invent.
I want to hear something bad, because good things are too good to be true.
I know you might not want me to call you sir, but the thing is... Well,
Pinakida will be fine.
Okay, that's great. Pinakida, yeah. So I am basically a gaming animator. I'm in Bangalore. So
I've heard about you. Yeah.
Oh, that's great. Thanks. So, my question might be a little bit off from what you have discussed over here, because I would more concentrate on what the scenario that I'm seeing of the artists in India. So it really bugs me a lot, you know, to see where people still in this age, when the other countries are there much, like they're developing a lot in this industry. Here in India, the people still think cartoon as Chota Bhim or like comics to be something very mundane, and gaming just means PUBG for them. And you know, I have faced this thing that in this age where people generally go for being a doctor or an engineer, the guys who are within quotes thought to be not so academically proficient or something, they are the ones who go for these fields, which is kind of very not a good thing to see, because people they say that they're growing, but they're not actually growing in this manner. So what do you think could bring some awareness of people in getting into these things and developing
for example
things?
I must tell you, look at the Gond artists. For them, art is a way of life, right? So for them, it's absolutely a way of life. Nobody knew about them until, people like Swaminathan discovered them. And today, I mean, you cannot even touch a Gond art, if you go to the Centre Pompidou, they are in Louvre, the new Louvre, they had a huge, huge exhibition. They're exhibited in MoMA, so they're extremely costly. So, they somehow evolved their art and made it very global. And you, of course, has to get Changar for that, give credit to that. Similarly, I think so for comics, for example, and you are talking about gaming and all these things. The problem in India is that I must blame ourselves more than anybody else. Look, I am talking to students here, and most of the students fear art. They don't look at art as part of their life. There are people who can draw and there are people who cannot draw. So you know what we are doing is we are actually segregating the artists away from people. So if you, so if somebody talks about that, oh, you are so arty, right? The others are lesser or others are doesn't care. So you know the main problem is drawing is very much part of our ecosystem. The very if we understand that, if we understand the storytelling is very much part of our ecosystem, I think it will improve. One of the problems with comics that I see is that many have stories, they don't cannot draw. Some can draw, but they don't have stories. I think, again, this is not a good scenario, but one of the problems is we don't have enough, we don't have enough content. So the problem is we, whenever we talk about, say, comics, we go to Chota Bhim, or whenever we talk about, you know, gaming, for example, say Indian gaming will always be based on mythology. The problem which we need to get out of is that we need to tell contemporary Indian stories throughout. The moment we turn to mythology, and mythology is not bad, but the thing has been done so much, you know, things that has been done, you have to be, you have to have a fresh perspective, you know, you need to somehow tell your story in a very refreshing manner. So whether it's a video game, the main problem, look at the video gaming industry in India, you don't have enough games. Whenever you have a game, so you have a film game, so you have a game on a film personality or a cricket personality, and you have some mythological themes. That's it. But what about very interesting stories that are there around? Why can't we construct games around that? We haven't done it. What about, say, for example, I want to make a game around the city of Calcutta. I can make that. And I can make it a kind of a flaneer-like game. You can go around the city. It can be an architectural game. Have we ever thought of that? We haven't. So the main problems, we are stuck within certain ideas. So when even Bhimayana was done, earlier, it was only the Amar Chitra Katha thing. This was extreme innovation. And they used a kind of an indigenous art in order to talk about something very different. It has never been attempted. And this is a world success. Bhimayana, and I must tell you one thing, the London Jungle Book that I showed you is 3 years back chosen as the book in the London Metropolitan Museum, as the book in the last 20, book, the best book on London in the last 25 years. Why? Because it innovated. So you can take a very indigenous art and go global, but the aim is to tell a beautiful story, a very contemporary, grounded story that has not been told by anybody else. And that is what Bhimayana does. That is what gaming industry should do. That is what all comics should do. That is what films should also do. So look, today films are going a completely different way. Look at the stories that we are getting, right? Look at even the contemporary Hindi film industry. It is changing because it is talking about new stories, new form of storytelling. Still is far off, but it's trying. So why don't we try that in games? Why don't we try that in comics? Why don't we try it in novels? Why don't we try it in classrooms? Why don't we try it to drill within every human being that you need to tell your story your way? Don't imitate a Bollywood potboiler. Don't imitate another artist. Don't imitate anything else. Try to do it your own way. I think if that's drilled in between, and remember, this is not a very special thing. You know, drawing is very important, but it's not special. Everybody can draw. Anybody. You draw stick figures and you tell a story. It can be a story. The story element is more important. And I believe that everybody has a story to tell. So if you think that's the way, things will change. Otherwise, if you follow trends, and that is where I tell students, never follow trends. All my students, the only thing that I teach is that you cannot follow what I do. Because I do it my way, you will do it your way. And you cannot have any idols. This whole thing is a bakwas, because the only idol, the only person you chase is you, what you are or what you are going to be tomorrow. This is actually a part of a Oscar speech. What I'm trying to tell is that this is Matthew McConaughey's author speech, Oscar speech. You just listen to him. He says, I have no idol. I chase myself 10 years later. And then 10 years, when I'm standing at 10 years, I chase myself 20 years later. And then I chase myself 40 years. So the story should be your own. So I that is where I think the gaming industry, whatever you do, fails. Pure fail. Because you are too concentrated, you are too obsessed with following trends. Now, it may not start off as a success, but it will reap, you know, benefits in the long run. That's what I think, Shukrim. And this is something that I'm talking from my heart. And this is also, I think, very edifying for the students. You have to do it your own. And there is no correct way. So even if your teachers say that's a wrong way, there cannot be a completely wrong way of doing things. There must be something correct in doing certain things. You cannot say that this is wrong. There is nothing called wrong. Of course, there are problems. You may have to correct it. But there cannot be something completely wrong. So that is what I feel. And this is purely my way of looking at things. Maybe others may differ. But this is what I look at.
Thank you so much. Like, it's been a real honor to, you know, it's been a real honor to listen to you. I'm speaking just out of my heart, you know, like.
No, of course. This is follow your heart, but of course you will be wrong. But there is nothing called complete wrong, and I think there must be something in it which will be there. Of course, you have to struggle a bit, but there will be benefits.
It's really like when you're talking, it was feeling like I'm listening to some documentary without the video part. So,
no,
so it was really good. So I don't know whether,
Okay, Ahuna.
Okay, fine.
Thank you. There is one, black and whites are also colors, Prantika tells. Yeah, black and white are colors, but yeah, they are, but they are also what you call the blank space, the negative space or white space. It's the use of space. So black is a color and the whiteness is basically the negative space, the blankness. So you etch the black within blankness. The blankness is the matrix. The white is not. So white is culmination of all color, or it's the blank space within which you etch the black. Yeah. So there is a bit of a difference between that, but let me leave it to that, because I think this becomes very complicated if I go to color, because you go to color analysis, you mention color separation, you mention others, and then suddenly it becomes very complicated.
All right, thank you so much, sir. As usual, it has been amazing, wonderful, what should I say?
Thank you so much. People have tolerated me so much.
Like, what should I say after your, like?
No, I don't think I'm good enough to be tolerated.
I do not have words enough to, like, frame a proper structured sentence.
Don't try then.
ma'am, do you have anything to say, or I should make a formal closure with this? Ma'am, would you?
Okay. That is a vote of thanks part. And then wind up.
All right. So thank you so much, sir. I on behalf of English department and everybody, I'm pretty sure everybody was spellbound listening to you. And this has been happening since ages. Like, you make speeches which are spellbinding. So what else can I add to this? So yes, let me make a formal closure of this. So thank you so much, sir. And for this web lecture series, I must thank our principal, ma'am, Shagota Dash Mohanto, who is also the patron in chief of our college, our IQAC coordinator, Dr. Arun Kumar Nondi, our convener, of course, Madhumita ma'am, our HOD of English department, associate professor of English, other conveners, Obhishek Choudhury, who is the assistant professor of English, Zakia Kalam. Zakia is present over here. Zakia, the assistant professor of English. There is also Obhijit sir, who is right now suffering from COVID. He is affected. Oh. Yes, he is tested positive. In fact, his entire family is tested positive with COVID. And he is also another convener. And apart from them...
By the way, Ahana, he has recovered.
All right.
Oh, wonderful.
All of them, thankfully, all of them have recovered.
Oh, wonderful.
Apart from them, the other convenants are Navonita, Momita, and me, who are the SACT of the department. And I must also thank Anirban sir, Anirban Banerjee, Dr. Anirban Banerjee of Zoology Department, who has been extremely, extremely helpful in sorting out the YouTube streaming for us. So thank you, sir. We have actually disturbed sir at very odd hours, and he has been extremely helpful. So thanks to him. So this is all, sir. And if you permit, then I'll make a closure. I'll end the meeting then.
Thank you. I mean, I'm absolutely very, very happy to, you know, really talk about this, you know, talk about Bhimayana before all of you students. And thank you so much for joining in. Thank you so much.
Students have actually dropped in messages of how they have been actually enjoying your lecture. Yes. Like last message is by Probahu, who says that, sir, we hope we may have another session from you on color analysis in Bhimayana.
Ah. that requires another session, yes.
And if apart from that, some others also. So,
thank you.
Thank you so much, Didi. Thank you, Ahona. Thank you, Zakia.
আমি
বসে আছি এখানে,
সেটা খুব ভয়ানক ভালো না, কারণ অনেক সময় মন খুলে না বলতে
পারলে
ছেড়ে দাও ওনাকে. Good night.